Grey's Anatomy, the most iconic binge-worthy drama, is back, along with answers to the biggest cliffhangers. Will Teddy survive? Will Joe and Link finally find happiness together? Meredith returns along with fan faves like Arizona. You can now stream every episode of Grey's ever on Hulu and new episodes next day. Watch new episodes of Grey's Anatomy Thursdays at 9, 8 central on ABC and stream on Hulu.
Hey there! Did you know Baker's always gives you savings and rewards on top of our lower-than-low prices? And when you download the Baker's app, you'll enjoy over $500 in savings every week with digital coupons. And don't forget fuel points to help you save up to $1 per gallon at the pump. Want to save even more? With a Boost membership, you'll get double fuel points and free delivery. So shop and save big at Baker's today. Baker's, fresh for everyone. Savings may vary by state. Restrictions apply. See site for details.
This episode is brought to you by Pepsi Wild Cherry. Pepsi Wild Cherry is bursting with delicious cherry flavor and a sweet, crisp taste that gives you more to go wild for. Getting wild may look different these days, but whether it's opting for a solo Friday binge watch or a big night out, everyone can indulge in their wild side with Pepsi Wild Cherry, also available in Zero Sugar. So grab a Pepsi Wild Cherry and get wild.
Hi, Andrew.
Hello, Will.
And welcome to Warrior Martial Arts Television. Thank you for coming on board and looking forward to talking to you about Warrior Season 2, also about Season 1. The first big question is, you play a key character conceived by the late Bruce Lee. How did you find your place in the role, knowing whose shoes you're filling? Because in a sense, you're playing the Bruce Lee character that would have been in this show when he first conceived it. How was that? How did you find sort of the process of getting into being the character that Bruce Lee created, given that Bruce Lee is an iconic martial arts legend? You've got to then step into those shoes and almost become a sort of Bruce Lee character.
Yeah, I think, Will, you're a martial artist yourself, I'm guessing.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. So, you know, like, I think it's the same, it's a similar principle. So I can metaphorize martial arts stuff with you, which is cool. It's like, you know, like when you're learning a form or a punch, or a technique kick, now you can see the master, how, you know, your master might be, you know, your teacher or someone ahead of you in the class might be doing that technique brilliantly and beautifully, or, you know, they might have made this come up with this thing. But all you can do is do it to the best, because, you know, you're different. You know, you've got different angles to your body, your different lengths, different different things you have to different strengths as well. So I think all it was going, okay, well, I can't. I mean, and they cast me, you know, knowing that I was just doing what I wanted to do with the character, and I think that's what Bruce Lee himself would have wanted. You know, I think his whole philosophy about expressing yourself and not trying to duplicate others, and finding your own way and not replicating the master, but going after what they were seeking. I think that was the philosophy I think I brought to it, which was, this is my take on this character. This is my, there's, at first there were lots of, you know, watching his films and reading biography and his life and his philosophies and that stuff. But then it was like, okay, well, this character is, this is in Jonathan Chopper's world, you know, it's if Bruce Lee was still around, you know, and he was too old to play the part, he wouldn't want someone to do a imitation of him. Maybe elements of his style or what he believed in, or, you know, those things, but it wouldn't be mimicry of Bruce Lee himself. So I kind of operated under that kind of philosophy of, this is me doing this character to the best of my ability for Bruce. We're going to throw in some nods and styles, and that's a pinpoint, a kind of a guiding point to how he fights, and an element of his character, but it's not the whole character. So it was kind of under that philosophy, like when you do martial art techniques, and you have to really, you might see someone else do what you think is better or how you would like to do it, but you can only do your punch in your way to the best of your ability, or kick to your way in the best of your ability. So it was very much under that kind of philosophy.
And you do it very well. I mean, it's very convincing and unique, and I think it's a really cool take on a character. So hats off to you for that. Following on from that question, what is your martial arts background, and did you continue training with that whilst you're out in South Africa? So just first thing, what's your martial arts background, and how did you bring that to bear in the character, if at all?
I did it for I'm quite an obsessive person. Once I get my mind on something, it becomes my life. So when I was about 10, played Tekken. I grew up Jackie Chan films and the cool. Jet Li. I did actually grow up with Bruce Lee films, and he only really came into my life around Warrior. And my dad, he was a Kyokushinkai, almost black belt. And I was bullied. I studied a lot at the time. I did Taekwondo for about 3-4 years, and then I got injured, big injury on my gluteus maximus minimus and hamstring, and so I couldn't kick, and it hurt, and I couldn't walk for maybe up to a year. I couldn't walk properly, and still to this day it can sometimes cause problems. So I had to change then to something more with less kicks, because it just hurt and I couldn't walk. So I went to the Shaolin Temple UK, trained there for a bit, trained with some of the disciples there in Tufnell Park. I can't remember the place now.
Down by the railway line.
Down by the railway. It's changed a lot now, I think. And they had different classes there, foundations and stuff. And then they had different disciples who would teach out there, because I was all the way from Surrey.
Yeah.
So it was a long way for me to travel, about 2 hours. I tried to train in different classes, a little bit of sandbags, a bit of those foundational, what they teach at the temple, which isn't quite wushu, but it's Shaolin kung fu. Trained one good few different classes in England. I started doing acrobatic kind of stuff. Because I was interested in, I just found the Shaolin monks and how they could fly. So interesting. So I was more definitely, when I was younger, more on the flashier side of martial arts. And basically around 20 years old, I gave it all up because I didn't want to become a martial arts actor. I just wanted to become an actor I wanted to. So I stopped completely, and I lived a completely different life, quite a rebellious kind of life, typical out-of-work academic kind of life, drinking, partying, and being reckless. Warrior was my gateway back in. I had to completely approach it from a more philosophical standpoint and it's interesting because I found what attracted me to martial arts when I was younger doesn't attract me anymore. Like, I was very much attracted to the flashier moves, the wushu, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And now I find like Bruce Lee's work and style and also the more traditional styles, and also the more economic styles, the Muay Thai, the elements of MMA and stuff, I find really interesting. So, season one for Warrior was a lot of Wing Chun training, to get the that traditional background that Ah Sahm would have gone through.
Yeah.
And then season two, I went to Korea for about a month to study with the WTF Taekwondo guys there, and they taught me obviously how to kick and not get hurt, and that was a painful process, man, because they, every Taekwondo guy there, I know, I saw them, they're amazing, they're absolutely amazing, but a lot of them, they're like kids 15, 16, their knees are busted, their ankles are in wraps and everything like that. It's, I think Taekwondo is a young man's martial art, and then because kicking is, you know, or, unless you're super talented, like maybe some people who are, can just kick for days and days and days. But yeah, now I'm definitely more attracted to the more traditional. And so, yeah, my plan was to come back to England after this whole section of filming stuff, and I wanted to start Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. But lockdown happened, can't do it. What can you do?
Well, it'll ease eventually. Yeah. You'll be able to do some training at some point, somehow.
It's definitely, now I definitely want to go back to it and keep up training, but in a different, different form, and different things are appealing to me. I find different things beautiful about the thing, even just the notion of discipline, you know.
But on set and sort of prepping for the fight and the stunts like that, did you sort of train whilst you were there? Or is the schedule too tough to enable you to sort of train every day? Or did you manage to squeeze in just keeping fit, if not sort of fight moves and stuff like that?
Yeah, well, when you're filming, it's different because you do the boot camp kind of stuff, and then that's the main training period. And then you do train when you can, when you're filming, but that's a lot to do with the schedule. But yeah, when cameras start rolling, a lot of it is about maintenance and going, firstly, not get injured.
Yeah.
How do I, your body's fatigued because you're doing 14 plus hour days.
Yeah.
It's a lot about maintenance as well. Season two, I was trying to get to the lower body fat percentage and that changes as well, because then you've got to train differently because you're eating, consuming fewer calories, and you're having to, it's all about maintenance once it comes along.
It must be a fairly long production schedule because you're doing 10 eps in a run, so that's a beast of a schedule.
I think I'm more, that's how I used to spar as well, as I was more a short distance runner. You know, I put everything in my first round, and then after that, So I never played it that clever. I was similar to Hassan back in the day. You know, more hot headed and had more to prove. And this was like, okay, you've got to be smart. This is not it's different to like maybe how a martial art would go for a competition, where maybe I know they ramp it up for a few months and then it's got a series of fights, and then then after that they're there. But we're doing this for around 6 months, up to 6 months, I think. And so it's about and also the schedule changes. So fight scene might get pushed forward, or you might have a huge blocked ramp-packed week. And then you've got a fight scene right at the end of it, you've got a fight scene right at the beginning of it, and you've got to still do work on the acting. So it's a lot about just being smart and training smart rather than just training hard once you're filming. Series two was tough because we had a bunch of fights that were filmed almost right next to each other, side by side. And to bring your A game to that, and the reality of filming now is like, 14-hour days of being on set, and then you're outside and it's freezing, and you have to constantly warm up and warm down, and get fatigued and don't warm up, and then you might pull this and pull that, and you're trying to save your energy to give your all.
Yep.
So it's very different. Screen front is very different to real front, obviously.
Absolutely, but it all looks good. I mean, it's made a great series, and coming in with one of the fights you did. and this is a big fight, what was it like fighting and, spoiler alert, beating the UFC middleweight champion Michael Bisping? And obviously there's a massive disparity in size. So how what did it feel like? So what was that like for you, knowing you were up against him and then sort of having the to act into that role of I can do this, I am doing it, it's happening?
Yeah, well, I'm intimidated by that dude, rightfully so.
Absolutely.
I've got absolute respect for someone like him. Any UFC fighter, anyone who throws themselves into the ring and essentially kind of puts their life on the line. Yeah. I've got absolute respect for the man, Michael Bisping. I've got absolute respect for, because I couldn't do what he did or does. Mm. And I've got to say, he just like everyone on Warrior, I mean, he took those, I don't know how to spoil it, but maybe, is this going to come out after?
There are trailers out already with it in, but, so don't worry.
Yeah, the trailer's out already, so that kick to the face, he took that like the man, did it multiple times. I didn't want to disrespect the guy, because, you know, it's a class that would kick him out, but, you know, he would turn me to shreds, and I'd happily let him turn me to shreds, because I got respect for that dude, for what he does and for what he did, and we don't have that many British UFC champions, do we? Is he the only one?
He is our only current one, yes.
Or maybe he's done every one. So anyway, that was the thing. But just like anyone said, we knew that this was something bigger than looking cool or being tough. Yeah. And we're helping tell a story for Bruce Lee, for his fans, for a story for a period of time, and that needs to. Deserves to have to be told. There was no ego about it at all. There was no ego about that whatsoever. I thought the fact that I kick him in the face in one thing, I felt like, I'm not going to have a big fight scene with him? Oh, okay. It was like a kind of a comedic beat there. I hope he's okay with that. And he was. There was no ego. I think he's as much a man. A man of principle and integrity. He's a bit of a hothead and a wild card too, but he's a man of principle and integrity just as much as a great fighter. And that was a privilege, I guess. Not many people would be able to say I kicked not many normal people, normal actors like me would be able to say I kicked the UFC champion in the face. So,
To say you knocked him out as well, clean, with one kick, that is pretty impressive. So
that's I damn did. And he didn't. Michael was fine.
I think he's a great personality in his own right as well. So I think he also brings a lot of stuff to whatever he's involved with. I think he's got a good acting career ahead of him as well. I'd like to see more of him doing stuff.
Yeah, he's an interesting guy, and I think I just really respect that, you know, I just respect any person who works, they put their ego aside, and I think that's how you get good, be part of good performances, be part of something good, and he did that, and I think that's the right attitude for sure.
Cool. So, and just sort of follow-on question then, sort of character development and getting yourself into the role of Ah Sahm. Did you work with Shannon Lee, one of the exec producers of the piece, and obviously his Bruce Lee's daughter, to sort of get a sense of feel about what Bruce Lee was all about? Or was she a lot more hands-off and just gave you notes and text and stuff like that? Or how did that process work?
A bit of both, actually. I do remember early on, I said I wanted to have, and we did have a few chats, because I wanted to find out who he was behind the image of the icon, you know?
Yeah.
I wanted to find out who he really was, you know, behind closed doors. But she said... she encouraged me early on to not focus too much on on Bruce Lee and that what I was thinking with my interpretation of it what I wanted to do, if it was what Bruce Lee would have wanted me to do. So she just encouraged me and she gave me tidbits of information here and there, but nothing more than I needed, I guess, with the big picture.
That's a brilliant way forward, because otherwise you end up having to try and copy something rather than interpret. And I think what she and you've done is made something very unique and cool, which brings on to a follow-on question to that is, Warrior has had fantastic success around the world. Series 2 is on the way, it's coming out, and eagerly awaited. What do you put down the success to? Is it because it's sort of a universal sort of David and Goliath or good versus bad type story? Or is there something else that's going on as well? Is it sort of some magical chemistry?
I think it's more the magical chemistry. It's the right people, the right time, the good writing, good characters, which were created by good people, and so many actors as well. So many of the cast, a lot of them brought everything to their roles. And everyone, and this, I think the show meant so much to most, because most people on the set, they have either grown up with Bruce Lee or he inspired them.
Yes.
You know, so it was like, how do we do this right? How do you bring justice to not justice, it's a bit different. It's more like, how do we pay homage and our respects to this guy and to this story that he wanted to tell? And I think, that's probably what people are responding to, you know. And then there's the representation aspect, and there's the fact that I think it's more of a grey story, you know. It's more, there's no necessarily good and bad. Everyone's kind of painted a bit grey and have their own motivations and stuff. And I think it's good storytelling mixed with a great cast, and then Brett Chan and making the great psychography. It meant so much to so many people. Mm-hmm. Since then, other people have gone on to do other jobs, but they still message me, and I'm still in touch with them, and they say that for them, some of these people have been working for 20 years, mm-hmm. 30 years, some of them, and they said to them that to them was one of their most special experiences they've had work-wise. So I think it's that magical combination of things that it was bigger than us.
So in many ways, it's sort of a defining piece for lots of people. It's become something bigger than the parts. It's become defining.
I mean, that's what it should be about in a day. Like, you're telling a good story, and you're telling, you're doing it right, and it's not about trying to look cool or pretty or whatever, even though there's some of that aspect to it. But, beneath that, there's a real heartbeat there, which I think... it's such an important thing for any story.
What a sort of slight tangent from that, then. Do you think there's a similarity between the tough lives and that tough people had to lead in both Warrior and Peaky Blinders? Is it sort of a common thread between them? Partly you were in both.
I think so. I think there's probably a lot of the zeitgeist of what. It's conscious for people, and there's certain beliefs and feelings that we all, I think, universally or on this world we have. And I think, certain stories really resonate with, seem to kick off. And I think, Breaking Bad, for example, that, blew up and way bigger than what they first thought. And there was a similar film about a guy who's, is about an underdog who's trying to make the best of a bad situation or what he can. And I think those stories, we've never seen that with with this kind of Asian twist to it, Warrior, but at least in the West. And I think that is something that people, I'm attracted to personally. And, I think that's a story of, people who are trying to be, it kind of inspires you first that it's not as bad as as back then, and those people watching people who make it work and make it best out of bad situation work or make tough decisions. I think that is something that we're all interested in, I think.
Brilliant answer to a not very good question. I didn't phrase it very well. But it's sort of coming around to the idea that sort of, I mean, it's the legacy of Bruce Lee, and the same thing with Peaky Blinders and things like that, is there's telling stories that are still relevant today, in that they're sort of dealing with racial barriers and boundaries that Bruce Lee broke down. And then the main thing is that standing up for the little guy, of that sort of the David and Goliath type story arc.
Yeah.
As well. So, yes, you did answer it brilliantly.
Well, I just said the thing on that. No. Oh, sorry. Yeah, no. I'll just end it quickly. But, yeah, it's quite eerily, some things are quite eerily relevant. And some things or bits of history that we've done before, and then we look to the current climate and go, oh, we haven't changed that much, or we've, or on a belief level, we're humans is pretty similar, even though we've got technology and fancy stuff all around us. It's on a belief level, on a human level, it kind of strikes something home, like, oh, damn, we need to change, we need to, it hasn't changed that much since back then, even though the exterior formed, we've got fancy cars and laptops and stuff, but...
Exactly.
Yeah, it's shocking sometimes.
It is. So on a slightly different note, it's from Series 1 to Series 2. Did you feel you sort of had to change up Ah Sahm and bring new things, new sort of elements to the character, or have you sort of kept it fairly consistent?
Yeah, definitely, man. I felt like there was a lot of this talk about a Western, of how this is like a Western, and I was like, oh, yes. I wonder, okay, this is episode 5 of the Western, but what about the whole show? And it is, the format is similar. It's a drifter who comes to town, learns of the problems of the town, just like a, the traditional, I can't remember the terminology that they use for that drifter character that comes from out of town, learns the plight of the town. It's like the Jimbo. And then he learns the plight and he fights for the people, And so season one was very much him just learning about it and seeing the world and almost reacting and kind of unable to make the change. And so when I was discussing stuff with Jonathan, it was like, I think now's the time that he's going to be on his front foot. He knows who to trust and who not to trust. And he knows the game a lot better here. So he's going to be on his front foot driving for things a lot more. So this is the stage, the atmosphere of the Western, where they're starting to become more involved and taking action now. They're in a position to take action. I think season one, he was very reactive, and he had to be because he's a complete fish out of the water. But now season two was like, he's got to be kind of driving for trying to make things, stirring stuff up and making change and creating different things. And he's a smart guy. He's a witty smart guy. So he's going to be playing with a lot of chess pieces,
Yeah.
So there was that element which was added further down the line, I think.
Cool. Well, yeah. It's all good. I'm up to episode 8 and I've been loving it. So thank you.
Oh, man, you've got 2 episodes to go.
I've only got 2 episodes to go, yeah. So.
I'm hoping. I don't want to raise your... I'll raise your expectations. You're in for a treat, I reckon.
Cool. I'm looking forward to it. I'm taking it nice and slow. I didn't want to. I binged at the beginning, and then I thought, I've got to slow down, just so I can enjoy it. Anyway, so next question is obviously the production returned to the San Francisco set in South Africa. What is special about filming in that great country? Is there anything about it? Is it particularly unique, or just can you talk a bit about sort of the whole process of making the show?
Yeah, I mean, so Cape Town. I think people were talking about there's a magic energy there there's this huge mountain, there's the beach nearby, it's sunny, it's incredibly beautiful, but then obviously there's the poorer, tough parts of it which we can see, but the people there, the mindset that they a lot of them have, especially the crew. Like, if we didn't have such a great crew on South Africa, in Cape Town, as a warrior, the show probably might not be what it is, And I think they helped make that happen. And it's a relatively small budget Warrior for a TV show of what it looks to be, you know. But they, I think, even, I mean, yeah, there's people that they a lot of the actors that I speak to, and even some of the team, production team, like they felt that they were creating something special, and they were part of it. And some of the people, like all the stuff that you don't know that goes on in a film set, like, you know, you might be having a really down day, and then an AD, you know, have a chat with you and lifts your spirits, or it makes you kind of not question your life. There were so many moments of that, and it was so many good people on that shoot that, and so it was the people there, it was their spirit, it was the, you know, my makeup artist, Amanda, she, you know, season two was tough to shoot, and she was there, and there were so many people that were there, which for everyone that, as a family, you know, a big extended family kind of made it work. And then there's, on top of that, there's the damn food, and that food is amazing. And it was hard to resist a lot of the things there.
And great wine as well.
Great wine, yeah. I mean, I couldn't drink that much, but some people went on them wine
tours.
What do they call it? Wine things, tours.
Yeah.
They come back absolutely trashed.
Yeah, big ones recover.
Yeah, that wine is great then.
A last question then. Okay. What are your plans now? Is it more TV, more movies, some theatre? Obviously, lockdown's going to get in the way of whatever it is, anything. And is there a possibility for Series 3? I'd like to say that there is, please.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry if I'm cutting you off because I think it's a bit choppy. But, connection. I'm going to work on another film, and I've just done a film, a G.I. Joe kind of thing, before that. For season three, it's obviously a lot of just the whole film industry is in state of flux right now, and sort of changeover stuff. It's definitely so many of our people's intentions to finish the story off and to bring it to wrap it up properly and you know, finish telling the story that Bruce didn't want to tell. Like, this is more than just a TV show. It's a huge idea come to life from a legend, and I think we want to finish it off in the way that I think it rightfully deserves. So it's all, in all of our intentions to do that. It's just up to the fans and the reception to help make some noise to make that happen, you know? And then we can put it in action. You know, it might be something like Deadwood, you know, where they revive it back in a couple of years' time as a mini-series or something where they finish it off and bring it all together. Well, who knows, basically, right now.
Who knows, but my sense of watching the screen, as I've been privileged to see, I think it has definitely built on series one, extends it. It's as interesting, action-packed, and great story. And really, I want to see more of it. So I hope that more of it happens. And I hope to get to talk to you again at some future point. And maybe if some things, we can actually do a filmed interview with you
at
some point.
Yeah, that'd be a pleasure, man. Yeah, hopefully at one point or something. Yeah, that'd be good. And I'm really glad you enjoyed the show, though, because a lot of hard work and heart went into it. And
on every frame, it's there. You can see it. Some stunning fights, and good on you for pulling it off. And it's a great show. So I've enjoyed it.
Thanks so much, Will.
Thank you very much for your time.
Once you get to 9 and 10, I'm curious how you like the ending of it.
Well, I can't wait.
You'll have to let us know, and we'll report back to Andrew.
Yeah, bye,
Will.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Andrew. Look forward to speaking to you again.
Take care of yourself.
And you too. Thank you.
doesn't matter. Okay, yeah.
Sports Social Podcast Network.
With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to... Has anyone seen the bride and groom?
Sorry, sorry, we're here. We were getting lucky in the limo and we lost track of time.
No, Lucky Land Casino, with cash prizes that add up quicker than a guest registry.
In that case, I pronounce you lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Daily bonuses are waiting. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.